So without further ado, and hoping we can be in the courtyard with a glass of wine quite soon, or beer, or soft drink, of course, I'll move us on to the last session and invite some very brief reflections, I think, hopefully able to talk for extensively, from three different people. So I'm sure you have ideas about how you want to reflect, but I don't need to explain what that might be. So first of all, I'd like to invite Susan Michie. Professor Susan Mickey, who's director of the Centre for Behavioural Change at UCL and has been part of the steering group of the ethics project that we've been doing from the beginning. And who I came to know on the steering group of the wellbeing, the Grand Challenges Human Wellbeing Committee. So, Susan.
Thank you very much. And I'm sorry I wasn't here yesterday, but I have been here today. And I wanted to reflect on a couple of things, really. Going right back to this morning, which is a long time ago now, the issue of corporate sponsorship, and also the issues of the last two sessions, which were about essentially the relationship between researcher and researched. But not anything particularly specific, but just that both of those really are complex systems. And I think we need to understand them as complex systems as a first step to how we move forward and improve them and improve our practice. Really, we could have a whole other session just looking about, okay, where do we go forward in terms of improving all of this? I just want to illustrate with a couple of things. Firstly, in the Centre for Behaviour Change, which was launched a year and a half ago now, we thought we should write some ethical guidelines. Specifically, or most specifically, about who we accept money from. And we looked for UCL ethical guidelines and couldn't find any, and looked for Grand Challenges ethical guidelines and couldn't find any. So we just began making our own. And we were thinking about the particular industries that we would and wouldn't accept money from. And everyone was clear, not the tobacco industry, and actually UCL signed up to that. We also said, not the alcohol industry. We also said, not the arms industry. But when it came to the oil industry and the food industry, there was more controversy. And so it's agreed that beyond those three, we'd do things on a case-by-case basis. But it did force us to think about, well, what's underpinning all of this? What would make us say, well, yes, we wouldn't accept money from this and wouldn't from another? And one of the issues is that one has to get to the underpinning principle. So we've got an overarching ethical principle, which is about promoting human well-being. But today, the words, various words have been used, but I think one of the issues is that when one thinks about the ethical underpinning, one also has to think about value systems. And I think in research, we don't talk about values as much as we should. So some of the concepts that have been talked about today, or words that have been mentioned, justice, inclusion, social equality, environmental sustainability, we have issues about war and peace. And really it comes down to, a lot of it comes down to what kind of society we want to live in. So I think that those big discussions should be had more explicitly. But the second issue, which is about the complexity, is that if one wants to take something like, say, the alcohol industry, it's complex because where do you start and where do you stop in terms of other organisations who work with them? And there's all sorts of, not just direct relationships, but for example, Drink Aware, which is a charity, I think, that's funded by the alcohol industry, get invited me to some, you know, swanky dinner, and I said no. But you know, there's lots and lots of gradations of steps along from the primary sort of monetary interaction. So I think that's the sort of thing where we need to develop an understanding of a complex systems and how the whole thing works and interacts, and develop very clear criteria which are value and principle based. To help with these decisions. along the way. But there are a lot of complexities in terms of working with people, whether it's other disciplines, whether it's even colleagues in one's own discipline, but the further one gets away from what one does oneself, the more acute these are. But differing expectations and roles and comfort zones, and especially incentives. And I think a big secret of working well with whoever it is to understand their incentive, the incentive systems that they're part of. And it's got to be able to be a win-win situation. It's got to be able to benefit and be good for whoever one's working with, as well as oneself. And the more one can be explicit and communicate in an honest, direct, open way, the better. And the word about reflection is really important. We're human beings. We make mistakes. The important thing is to listen and understand about those mistakes and be able to move on from them. So that whole area also is complex. So I'm not going to say anything more, but just to say, I think it's in itself, we need to think about investigating it. So conceptualizing it, understanding it, and researching it, and developing explicit methodologies for doing this well, so we can more easily hand it on, whether it's through training, whether it's through guidelines, formal guidelines, or whether it's through other kinds of interactions. So anyway, I think that's the stuff of a whole other conference.
Thank you so much. Absolutely. And then I'd like to invite Professor Stephen Liu, who's director of the Creative Exchange Institute, and also the Academy of the Creative Industries and Performing. That's not actually performing arts, it's the performing arts in University of Tessek. Nice title right at the end there. I did say at the beginning of the conference that there were no flights attached to this conference at all. Steve was already coming through. But I guess we should be sharing some of that carbon footprint.
Well, yes. It was just an opportune moment to be here when the conference is on. Look, I took scrappy notes right through the conference. I found it extremely enlightening for the fact that it opened up numerous fields, even under the banner of ethics. And I was interested at looking at basically where the limits of ethics are in terms of our contemporary field. And what I found was, there are limits all the way down. So basically that's practicing ethics, is practicing at the limit. Actually conjuring up the limits of practice in that way. I've got four rough categories in terms of where I see the limits are. And for the want of actually spouting continental philosophy just between us and drinks, it's probably the most unethical thing I can do. But anyway, so these are four kind of rough points that I think would venture in a kind of more research, and I think these are forms for different conferences altogether. So the first one is what I call the openness of second order futures. And we've heard quite a bit about the limits of the shift scale. And this is about the scale in relation to ethical practice. So when we're dealing with fossil fuels, when we're dealing with climate change, when we're dealing with transnational borders or poverty, war, that actually do not respect human-made sort of borders. Plus, if we go to the other end of the scale, we talk about viruses and bacteria, virology and bacteriology, in terms of how it transgresses the inside and outside of human bodies. Here we have the infinitesimal and the planetary. And so how do we actually kind of deal with that? And this is certainly one major limit of ethics. Associated with that is what I call the kind of second order limits, the second order futures. We've heard over and over again that although we have a very clear aim, relatively clear aim of where our ethical practices are, the practices themselves, even our research, would have second order impacts on communities that perhaps we didn't foresee. And with those impacts are further impacts. So here we have again a kind of sliding scale or an exponential scale of impact. not only do we look into the future, we also have this problematic of reconstructing the past. We constantly do this in all of our ethical practices. We define who communities are by our very discourses, by our very policies, by our very procedures. And so in the kind of definition of these communities, of publics, of nations, through our practices, we are reconstructing the past, and we need to really kind of look at the kind of relationship between, the imbrication between the past and the future. That's one point. The second kind of major area, very briefly, is what I call the axiomatics of capital procedure and rights. And what I mean here is that I think ethical practice has a lot to learn from capitalism. I know it's terrible to say this, but
I'm all ears.
What is interesting about capitalism is it is so very good at kicking its feet from under it in order for its own gain. Think about it. At every move that it makes, it decodes, and it decodes because it can then recode it, you know, to basically find a new market for that. If ethical practice or the kind of practice of ethics is about finding kind of axioms, what Bruno Latour would call the mobile immutables, you know, something that placed in the almost array of flow of information and you know our kind of practices, we're able to kind of diffract you know everything from discourses to kind of emotions and affects to information to data and so forth. And that diffraction is the opening up of the possibilities for redefining who we are to start with, and certainly how we could actually welcome an other which we have not predicted. So that's a really interesting point. I mean, I can't elaborate on this, but I think there is something here about ethical practice in that way. And this notion of information too is very interesting. This morning session, where information is not just pure that kind of flows unknowingly, you know, through the sphere, but what information does, and this is again kind of capitalism at its best, information transforms itself at every step based on, you know, the imbrication of the information that's come before that. So it's not information, but information. So through information, there is a constant mutation of what data is and what information is, and therefore what the public, the human, the other would be. The third point is what I call the kind of Anthropocene in the service of the coming other. I know, big word. I thought I would like to put everything into the title. So what I mean here is this notion of human rights in relation to individuality. Of course, the kind of protection of the individual is paramount in underlying human rights. But the issue here is this notion of the kind of processual in terms of any kind of ethical practice is the constant redefinition of the individual. And here, this is where we need to kind of make individual processual, and therefore we come up with a process, let's say we call it individuation or a kind of, you know, in a verb sense. So human rights becomes the right to individuate, the right to become human. And the notion of kind of becoming human is basically what we deal with other cultures and our communities, because all our practices are constantly naming, you know, people. Naming groups, naming the environment, naming animals and non-human others. The kind of naming is always going to be resisted, right? If especially when we misname someone, or we misname a group. And this is what Ranzier calls the redistribution of the sensible, that ethical practice is the negotiation of the wrong naming of kind of groups, the constant battle kind of between that. And that, of course, precipitates a type of, or a notion of kind of solidarity that is not fixed, that's always partial, that is always in progress. The point, you know, if we take that further, if we start to talk about non-human others and animals and the environment, the planet, for that there is no reciprocity, that there is no kind of relation back, you know, from the non-human other, because all of our thinking is really embedded within, you know, kind of human sort of dimensions. And therefore, if how do we then deal with the kind of indifference of the other that comes back to us? And this is Derrida's point about hospitality to the other, regardless of who comes. And that's a very fundamental limit of human ethics. And I like Sam Mockbee's quote that Jeremy Till put up yesterday, who said, you know, to help, so this is ethics basically, to help those that are not likely to help in return, and to do so as if no one is looking. You know, that's a really, really poetic way of putting it. And very lastly, this is, will take me 1 minute, this is the fourth point I call performative ethics, or performative ethico-aesthetics in response to humanity. Ethics is based on very clear perceptions, a lot of evidence that are, you know, knowable, that can be proven, procedures that can actually be laid out. But we've already seen that we actually need quite different modes of perception and sensation, and where this emotion, affect, and the imagination come in to ethical practice. This is where the aesthetic is. This is where we need to understand, I suppose, the, you know, especially from a kind of design and architect, I'm trained as an architect, where the kind of, you know, the thinking about spatiality and temporality and relationships or relationality between things, that is an aesthetic practice. And this is where, you know, the design disciplines can actually contribute most to a kind of sort of ethical thinking. And so it becomes almost a political, you know, sort of approach to ethics. Now, I'd just like to end by saying that, you know, I like this term ethical horizon, only because it is something that we continuously chase but never reach. But what we need to be ethical about, would be the work and the practice that we do in chasing the ethical horizon. And to make sure that work is work of beatitude. That work is work that really is quite beautiful en route to chasing that ethical horizon. Thanks.
So I'm going to give, I'm not sure if it's going to be the very last word, but all of us turning towards Professor Alan Penn, Dean of the Bartlett, who's been a great supporter of this project from the beginning. So, Alan,
Yes. The reflections I'm going to give are, actually I'm going to start off from the position of a dean. And a dean in the Bartlett, which is an interesting position to be in. It's a multi-part entity with many different practices, many different disciplines involved. And the reason I'm particularly interested in ethics is that if you want to hold any group together that otherwise might fragment and split up, it seems to be incredibly important to be able to establish the basis of what our shared values are, what we can agree to as shared values to hold the group together. And so it seems to me that in the case of the built environment, there's actually a need for us to understand a common ethical view of the world, if that's possible. It may well be a lowest common denominator, by the way, because there may well be specificities that apply to particular subgroups within the faculty. Those engaging in the global south will have a whole series of issues that may not be quite so important for those working in high-end architectural design in the Western world. However, I am convinced that there are certain things that we share in common. And I'm going to sort of try and run through that. The built environment. I think Andrea actually said that there are some issues which are, you know, a lot of ethical work has come out of thinking about the medical world. And that one has to rethink things a bit, and our in the medical world, you research very often by studying a lot of individual people. And you intervene in those people, and maybe the processes of research are the dangerous processes. And you have to be ethical in achieving informed consent in order to intervene, and you're doing case control comparisons, sometimes by intervening and not intervening in order to see whether or not there's a difference between the intervention. Is that ethical to not intervene on somebody with, you know, a suspected illness, and do you do it double blind? And there's a whole series of issues that inform a lot of medical ethical consideration. Now, of course, the built environment is nothing like that. There is no such thing as a set of cities that are comparable to each other as individuals might be in physiological and anatomical terms. In fact, every city is unique. And so the sort of processes that we go into in urban research probably have to start from a different point of view. It's very difficult, for example, to do case control. Even if you start looking at, I don't know, a tower block in Tower Hamlets and doing intervention in it, and then looking at the next tower block in Tower Hamlets, actually they're embedded in different places in the world. The occupants will have different demographies. There'll be a whole series of things that differentiate them and may be fundamental. So being able to consider these things as separate becomes problematic. So that set me to thinking around, well, what is it that is specifically built environment in terms of the research we do and in terms of the practices we have? Now, I must declare an interest here. I think that everything we do in designing in the built environment is actually fundamentally an act of research. We have an idea for what a building might do. We have an idea for what the nature of the community, an urban area might achieve. And actually, it's an experiment. We design something, we build it, and we, if we're good, we go back and look at the results. And that in itself is a learning process and an experimental research process. So for me, everything in the built environment, in daily practice, right the way through to the sorts of research we do as academics, is research. That means that our ethical research ethics responsibility goes right the way through practice. I don't think we can say, oh, I'm a practitioner, therefore I don't have to think ethically. I think it's more fundamental than that, though. What we do in building buildings or building cities affects the way that people are brought together or the way they're kept apart. We actually intervene by building walls in social structures. And I think there's a strong sense in which the reproduction of social forms depends on the environments we put people into. And the generation and production of new social forms depends on the way that the space of the built environment brings people together or keeps them apart. And so the ethical responsibility here is something that goes well beyond a responsibility to a particular individual. It's a responsibility to a general public at large and to future generations. It's not just our immediate client for the building that we need to consider. We can't just say that because we have a contractual responsibility to a client and they've commissioned this building, then we must do what they say. I think our ethical responsibility goes well beyond that to the public at large and to future generations. And so when somebody comes in and says, I want a building, but I only want minimum levels of energy saving as required by the regulation, there is a question you can raise as to whether that is actually an ethically responsible position to take. It's an open question. Now, if you talk to the professional institutions, the RIBA will say, no, your primary ethical responsibility is to your client. There's no absolute responsibility to a general public. It's not written in, you can't get sacked from the profession. The things you can get sacked from the profession for are diddling the client, things of that sort, but not for doing things that will impact negatively on future generations or the public at large. So I think that needs to be changed. Now, the built environment, in other words, is in a very particular position for me, and everything that we do, whether we're practitioners or researchers, has an ethical basis to it. The second thing I wanted to say is about the nature of ethics themselves. Now, it's a very simple thing, and it's already been referred to, and that is that ethics are essentially, for me, about rights, and they're about human rights, they're about rights, and they're also about values. I would say there is a single overriding human need, and therefore human right, and that is to autonomy. It's the ability of self-determination. There is also, with every right, a duty, and the duty is therefore to respect the autonomy of others. So I don't have a right to be a tyrant. That would be going one step too far. I don't have the right to oppress other people, because that removes their right to autonomy. But if we take that right to autonomy, it does actually underpin a whole series of other rights. It underpins rights to be able to work and to participate in the construction of society in a meaningful, productive way. It underpins the right to education. It underpins the rights that the people have to communicate freely and so forth. The problem, of course, with all of this comes up when we start thinking about power relations. And in power relations, this is where the tyrant or the terrorist are abusive of power relations. It becomes really important to start thinking about what that means when we think about autonomy. And for me, the issue is actually to do with reciprocity. We have to be able to say that the relations we construct between people are reciprocal. So, in engaging with a community or a group around some issue, the power to speak as well as the power to listen have to be in balance. There's a relationship of exchange and mutual. I thought the video was actually excellent on this, picking this up from a whole series of different cultural contexts. The importance of being able to engage on equal terms with communities from all over the world. This is not a community, this is not a cultural relative thing. There are cultural differences between different communities and their ways of working. This is an absolute, the right, if you like, to mutual and reciprocal relationships and exchange. And I think it affects us all in every area of research that we engage with others on. So, where does that place us then in a university? And this is something which I think is particularly important and has been touched on in various ways by a number of people this afternoon. I think universities are in a particularly privileged relationship to the world. We have this idea about the importance of academic freedom. It's highly protected and valued commodity, academic freedom. What does it actually mean? Well, it means that what the university is as an institution, as an object, is something which is there, and its role in society is to allow thinking through freely without others telling you what you should think, anything you want. It's a completely open field. That's a right that we hold as academic researchers. The duty that comes with it is the duty of respectful debate and the respectful listening to others. It doesn't mean I have to believe what that somebody else says. In fact, I should contest it. I should be critically listening to and reflecting on what others say. But the whole point about a university as a context within which to speak, the primacy here is on the respectful reception of others' ideas, the listening to what they're trying to say, and engagement in the debate that allows those ideas to move forward. On both sides, because it's reciprocal. It goes across the table in both ways. Now this can come into conflict, and it can come into conflict, I think, particularly when we talk with those from groups that have very specific agendas that they wish to pursue. And those, absolutely, those sorts of organisations, absolutely have their own set of principles that they are adhering to. It's just they're not necessarily the same as the university. And when we sit here as academic researchers with our academic hats on, I think we need to think about things one way. We might then go across the picket line and think here as, you know, somebody demonstrating on our rights to a pension or whatever the next thing is, and behave in a completely different way as an individual. That's one of the wonders of what individuals can do. They can have multiple hats. However, I think it's very important that we are absolutely clear on where we are, on whether we're an academic. Every time you talk, I'm thoroughly an academic, and everything you say to me is being recorded and listened to. Or when we actually move across the line and start becoming, if you like, political action takers in other contexts. Now, I think that probably is the area where the really interesting tension is. It's on that line between what we do as an individual, as we negotiate our position between firmly held beliefs about what's right or wrong in the world, and what we do as an academic with a duty to listen to others. And how that negotiation takes place is something you can only work out personally. That's an individual responsibility. But I think if we start from the right of all to autonomy, the right particularly of academics and academic colleagues, therefore, to freedom of speech, and our duties of academic debate and critical debate, I think we shouldn't go too far wrong. And for me, that holds the whole thing together. So I would hope that a built environment ethics is something we can all agree on, duty to future generations, general public, and that our specific way of pursuing that through our academic establishment would allow us to move forward in actually quite an interesting way.
I think taken together, those three are almost the starting point for a whole new conference. I don't propose we begin that conference now. I think we've heard from 41 speakers, for those of us who've been here through the last few days, all of which have been absolutely fantastic. So I'd like to know how you're feeling. Are you feeling like you've really heard enough and we wrap up now and conversations around these fantastic reflections happen outside? Does anyone feel they need to speak out about something? So, all that remains for me to do, I'm not going to
say
what you think about that. So, I'm not going to attempt to summarise anything. I think that would be very foolhardy at this stage. I think we've had an amazing set of conversations of all kinds of emotional tenor, which is to be expected and really great. There's a lot more work to do. I've been amazed by how much people have committed to this conference, particularly people who've taken on chairing sessions and putting those sessions together so carefully and thoughtfully, and all the people who have agreed to speak. I think it's been a really wonderful couple of days. It's one of those strange conferences, I've never really had it before, where the night before it began, I got messages from all over the world of people's support for the whole endeavour, and also how much they wanted to know what we were talking about. Many people couldn't be with us. And so we've been very, very lucky that the event has been recorded by Tracy Hannah, who came in at the last minute. Thank you so much. So we have all the recordings. We need to think about how we're going to use them and what we want to do with them, and obviously people's consent for us to do that. But I do think we have an amazing resource here that could be a teaching resource as well, particularly some of the conversations from the sessions. So I just want to thank everyone for all their contributions, all the contributions from the floor, the great questions that people have asked as well. Massive thanks to all the Masters and PhD students who helped out at the front desk. I think that's been a great thing. Thank you very much for helping. Thank you very much to the Bartlett for funding this event, and also UCL Grand Challenges Wellbeing, who also funded it. But I think my final thanks must go to Sol Perez Martinez. Sol, you have been believe or even imagined doing this conference without your help. So I'd just like to say thank you. If you ever fancy organising another conference.
Remarkably efficiently and in a remarkably interesting and open way. So thank you.